Dobrý deň. Všetkých vás vítam na mojej krátkej prednáške. Volám sa Barbora Pöš a pracujem na pozícii odbornej asistentky na Vysokej škole výtvarných umení v ateliéri odevného dizajnu pod vedením profesorky Julie Sabovej.
So my name is Barbara Pöš and I am working at the Department of Visual Arts as an assistant under the
Academy of Fashion Arts and Design.
No,
it's a studio of fashion design,
studio.
Academy of Fine Arts
Fine
and
Art.
Design in Bratislava.
Perfect.
And the head of the studio is Professor Julia Sabova. And I am assistant, and also I am teaching a few subjects there. And a prišla som, aby som vám predstavila svoju dizertačnú prácu.
And I came here to introduce you my work.
Na ktorej som pracovala zhruba pred 2 rokmi. Doktorantské štúdium trvalo asi 5 rokov.
That I've been working on more or less 2 years ago.
A názov tej dizertačnej práce bol postapokalyptická móda.
And the name of this work is called the post-apocalyptic fashion.
Na obrazovke vidíte praktickú časť dizertačnej práce, teda kolekciu odevov.
On the screen you can see the practical part of the dissertation work.
No a chcela by som vám trošku predstaviť vlastne, prečo tá kolekcia odevov vyzerá tak, ako vyzerá.
And I would like to tell you something about why does it look the way it looks.
A poodkryť vlastne systém tej práce, pretože mnohí z vás sú tu študenti odevného dizajnu alebo ľudia, ktorí sa zaujímajú o dizajn a o textil.
And just like to unreveal some myths and the process how I created because all of you and at least the majority of you are students and you have the same interests as I do.
A takisto by som vlastne vám chcela povedať o tom, čo som pred tými niekoľkými rokmi vlastne zistila, keď som tú doktorantskú prácu robila.
And I'd also like to tell you and share with you some stuff that I found out while I was working on this project.
Takže takto vyzerá finálna kolekcia, ale vlastne začala som niekde v momente, keď som uvažovala o tom, že o čom bude tá doktorantská práca, jednak o čom a jednak prečo ju vlastne robím.
So this is how the final collection looks, but I started forming my ideas even before I started working on the whole work, like before 2 years ago.
V súčasnosti je v dizajne všeobecne, ale aj v móde samozrejme pomerne ťažké nájsť ako keby siluety, odevy, tvary, strihy, všetci to asi poznáte, ktoré by boli nejakým spôsobom nové.
So nowadays it's very hard to come up with something creative when it comes to shapes, materials, silhouettes, something original because everything is very competitive.
A my dizajneri, alebo teda odevní dizajneri, máme často pocit, že všetko tu už bolo.
And more or less fashion designers have the feeling that nothing is really new, that everything has already been here and that we just been on.
Tým teda nechcem povedať, že toto tu ešte nikdy v živote nebolo, ale minimálne som mala pocit, že táto téma má zmysel.
I don't want to say that this is completely new and that like no one ever used this or no one ever get inspired by it, but I think it's at least partially new.
Takže začala som hľadaním nejakého bodu nula, nejakého miesta, kde by vlastne som sa mohla odraziť a kde by som nebola zaťažená minulosťou.
So I started with like searching for like a place, for a spot that I could start my project and start my thinking that is not very famous or it didn't go viral yet.
No ako vhodná mi vlastne v tomto smere prišla téma postapokalyptickej tvorby.
And I found out the topic of the post-apocalyptic creating.
Vlastne dostávame sa do priestoru, kedy civilizácia skončila, nie je.
Which is bringing us to to a place when the civilization ended and it doesn't exist anymore.
A vtedy vlastne ako keby priestor na vytváranie úplne nových vecí s pozostatkou vlastne zdrojov, ktoré sú starej civilizácie.
Therefore, there is a space to create new stuff and very original stuff from all the rest and from all that rested from the world.
Takže som začala hľadaním inšpirácie v postapokalyptickej tvorbe, ako sú filmy.
So I started searching for inspiration in sources like post-apocalyptic movies.
Ktoré mnohí z vás možno, že aj niektoré poznáte, sú vám sympatické, alebo nie sú, to v tomto momente nie je až také dôležité.
And you might even know some of them and you might like them, but you might also not, but it's not that important.
Niektoré z nich, čo som videla, boli v lepšej kvalite, niektoré nie úplne.
Some of them were in the very good quality, but some of them were not that great.
Potom som pokračovala v rešerši a objavovala som literatúru.
Then I kept my research going and I moved to literature.
Objavila som počítačové hry, ktorých je pomerne dosť na túto tému.
I moved to computer games, there are many computer games based on the topic.
Potom som pokračovala ďalej v hľadaní samotných odevov, ktoré by sa zaoberali touto témou, buď inšpirovaných počítačovými hrami, alebo filmami.
And then I tried to search for some outfits, for some designs and clothes that would be actually inspired by the topic I was exploring, so by the post-apocalyptic topic.
Dostala som sa aj k rôznym fotografiám, maľbám, ilustráciám.
I came across many pictures, photographs, illustrations.
A ako som ďalej pokračovala v hľadaní, pretože nechcela som, aby moja inšpirácia odevu pochádzala z odevu.
So while I was exploring and kept the research going, I realized that I didn't really want it my inspiration to come from already done outfit.
Rovnako som potrebovala získať niečo ako náladu alebo priestor, kde by som mohla zasadiť svoj odev.
Also I needed to basically get the mood or maybe even some space where I could make my outfit work, where I could put it.
Takže som sa skôr zamerala na krajinu.
So I focused on the nature and on the landscape.
Keď som tým, že vlastne tento výskum v tomto smere trval naozaj skoro 5 rokov.
And since the research kept going for almost 5 years.
Som sa dostala naozaj k mnohým zdrojom.
I just had many options and many opportunities to explore many sources.
A vlastne takým tým obyčajným vyhľadávaním som sa dostala k obrazom.
And just by a simple research, I got to see like actually pictures on the wall, I guess.
V ktorých ako keby na prvý pohľad nebolo úplne zrejmé, že ktoré z tých obrazov sú fikcia a ktoré sú realita.
And in these paintings at first wasn't really obvious whether it's fiction or whether it's reality.
Keď sa sami na to pozriete, tak vidíte, že ja som urobila takú koláž vlastne, aby som dokumentovala, že je naozaj ťažké rozpoznať, ktoré z tých pohľadov na Zem alebo miesta na Zemi pochádzajú z nejakého filmu a ktoré sú reálnymi fotografiami.
So just to demonstrate that, I created a little collage to make you see that it's very hard to tell whether something is reality, maybe coming from like a city or a village, or whether something is from the movie.
Potom som si vypichla niektoré obrazy pre vás, ktoré naozaj sú dobrým porovnaním toho, čo je realita a čo je fikcia. Tu vám ešte pomáhajú známi herci.
Then I prepared some pictures for you to show you that sometimes fiction can be really similar to reality.
Alebo napríklad tu. Sú to vlastne pohľady na zdevastovanú krajinu. Ten spodný napríklad je z filmu The Road. A neviem, či ho niekto z vás videl.
This picture is the view on the devastated landscape, devastated nature, and it's from the movie called The
Road.
The Road.
Cesta. A ostatné sú teda našou realitou.
And the rest is the reality.
Tuto je podobné zoskupenie. Na spodku je obraz filmu Book of Eli.
And this is very similar. This, it's a picture from the movie
Book of Eli.
Book of, yeah.
Takže tuto vlastne niekde som sa odpichla do toho momentu, že za tie miesta na Zemi, ktoré sú takýmto spôsobom zdevastované, je vlastne zodpovedný priemysel.
And I came into conclusion that for all these like destroyed landscapes and destroyed places, it's the industry is responsible for that.
A vlastne trh a globálna ekonomika a výroba.
And the market and the you know the contemporary and the economics,
just spotreba.
Economics, market,
consumption. Tuto na obrázku vidíte vlastne fotografiu z filmu Automata.
This is the picture from the movie Automata.
A v hornom rohu je vlastne obrázok Aralského jazera.
And in the corner there is the picture of the Aral Lake.
Aral Sea. Well, it's known as Aral Sea. Možno ste už o tomto prípade počuli. Je to veľmi známy prípad toho vlastne ako celé Aralské jazero, alebo 90% zhruba tohoto jazera vyschlo.
I don't know if you ever heard about the Aral Sea, but almost 90% is has been dried.
Pretože tá téma priemyslu, a teda textilného priemyslu a jeho výroby je veľmi široká.
And because the topic of the fashion industry and its creation is very big and very extensive.
Because it's a topic, I had to choose a small part of this topic because it's a lot of amount of information. Takže vlastne som si vybrala z výroby v textilnom priemysle, alebo teda v módnom priemysle som sa zamerala iba na výrobu odevov z bavlny.
So I decided, because it's a lot, I decided to focus only to the creation and the industry that's creating the products from...
Cotton. Bavlny. Na obrázku teda vidíte prípad Aralského jazera, ktoré, ako som povedala, skoro celé vyschlo, to vidíte v tom ľavom dolnom rohu.
So as I said before, you can see the picture of the Aral Sea that has been almost dried.
A zodpovedným za to je vlastne výroba v textilnom priemysle a pestovanie bavlny.
And for this it's responsible the textile industry and the cotton industry.
Dve rieky, ktoré napájajú Aralské jazero, Amu Darya a Sir Darya.
The two rivers that are actually ending in the Aral Sea, it's Amu Darya.
Amu Darya a Sir Darya boli vlastne odvedené na zavlažovacie kanály, aby sa mohla pestovať bavlna.
Have been transferred to irrigation canals to be able to care about the cotton.
Pretože bavlna je veľmi smedná rastlina a potrebuje veľmi veľa vody.
Because the cotton is very sensitive, it's very sensitive and
thirsty
and sensitive and it needs
a lot of water, yes. So this way, this Aral Sea disappeared. Takže preto vlastne Aralské jazero skoro zmizlo a tie zavlažovacie kanály boli vlastne stavané veľmi narýchlo kvôli plánovanému zisku a vo veľmi nízkej kvalite.
And this is basically why the Aral Sea almost disappeared, because of the industry, because of the need of money, because of the business.
A teda veľa vlastne vody, ktorá odišla z tých riek, síce nikdy nedorazila do Aralského jazera, ale nedorazila ani na bavlnárske polia, bavlnené polia.
And the interesting fact is the thing that lots of this water didn't even arrive to the cotton places, but it didn't even arrive to the sea either.
Začalo sa to všetko niekedy okolo roku 1960.
everything started around the year 1916.
A 1987 už sa rozdelilo na severné Aralské jazero a južné.
And back in the 1987 the sea was divided into the north part and the south part.
A južná časť v roku 2003 už mala iba 10% svojej pôvodnej veľkosti.
And the south part was back in the 2003 the south part only had 10% of the original amount of water
size also. Yes. Takže tam nie je problém len ten, že vlastne Aralské jazero už nie je.
So the problem is not really that the sea doesn't exist anymore, but
ale to, čo po ňom ostalo, je púšť.
But everything that that we have now, it's only a desert.
Ktorá je plná pozostatkov soli.
That is full of salt and all these things.
A toxických chemikálií.
And toxic chemicals.
Ktoré boli používané na hnojenie a udržiavanie bavlny.
That have been used to care about the cotton.
Ako pesticídy, herbicídy.
Like pesticides,
fertilizers,
yeah.
And so on. Takže vlastne pôda, ktorá tam zostala, je nepoužiteľná.
So the land and the land that stayed here is we can't really use it, is unusable.
A vlastne nebezpečná.
It's very dangerous as well.
Kvôli toxickým prachom, ktoré sa odtiaľ dvíhajú, keď sú búrky.
Because of the toxic dust that are going out of it.
A šíria sa po okolitých regiónoch.
And they're spreading around the region.
A ľudia žijúci v tomto regióne.
People living in this region.
Ak tam ešte nejakí zostali.
In case they stayed.
trpia vážnymi zdravotnými problémami.
They suffer from very serious health issues.
Ktoré asi pre krátkosť času nebudem všetky vymenovávať.
For example, or there are a lot, like.
Yes, there is a lot, mm-hmm. But I don't have so much time yeah. For the moment. Takže je tam veľká chudoba.
There is poverty.
Rybársky priemysel, ktorý bol veľmi bohatý v tejto oblasti, skončil.
The fishing industry, the catching of fish, that just ended.
A ľudia, ktorí tam ostali, sotva prežívajú.
And the people that stayed have barely money to survive.
Ďalším problémom textilného priemyslu súvisiacim s vodou.
Another problem about water when it comes to the textile industry.
Je farbenie.
Oh. Yes.
Dying.
It's dying.
Dying of textiles. Je to zase kvôli rýchlo meniacim sa trendom.
And it's basically all caused by the fast fashion trends because everything is changing very quickly.
A nízkej cene produktov.
And the low price products.
Používajú sa farbivá, ktoré nie sú bezpečné.
All the colors that are being used are not safe.
Fabriky, ktoré farby a spracovávajú textil, nedávajú pozor na to, akým spôsobom ošetrujú odpadové vody.
So the factories that are responsible for the coloring, the textile coloring, are not really careful and they don't really care what is the outcome.
A oni sa nestarajú jednoducho preto, že na to nie sú financie.
They also don't care because they don't have money.
Pretože cena fast fashion odevov je stlačená tak nízko, že sa nedá do toho zmestiť.
Since the price of a fast fashion product is so low that they literally don't have money to care even about this.
Farby, ktoré sú vypúšťané do riek, v tých riekach zostávajú veľmi dlho.
The colors that are being let into the rivers are staying very long.
Pretože sú robené na to, aby boli svetlo stabilné a termostabilné.
Because they are designed in a way that they resist light and they resist
termostabilné.
All the changes in temperature.
Yes. Takže a potom následné čistenie týchto odpadových vôd je zase veľmi finančne náročné, takže to nikto nerobí, alebo sa to robí len veľmi málo.
And again, the following cleaning of all this water, it's very expensive, so no one really does it, or it's been done very, very briefly and very rarely.
Všetky tieto malé katastrofy sa dejú ďaleko od nás.
All these little disasters are taking place like far away from us.
Takže nikto ich denne nevidí, nevie o nich, nepočuje o nich.
So no one really knows about this.
A preto je tak jednoduché vlastne ísť do obchodu a kúpiť si tričko za 5 eur.
And that's why it's very, very easy to go to a store and buy a t-shirt and pay only 5 euros.
Ale to, že sa takéto veci dejú ďaleko od nás,
but the fact that all these things take a place far away from us,
neznamená, že sa s nimi nestretneme.
It doesn't mean that we are not gonna ever come across them.
Pretože škodlivé a toxické látky, ktoré zostávajú v pôde, vo vzduchu alebo vo vode,
because all the toxic chemicals and toxic things that are being in our water and in the air,
sa dostávajú do reťazca jedla,
are actually getting to the food chain,
a môže sa nám vlastne dostať na stôl v nejakej konzerve alebo v kuse mesa alebo ryby alebo zeleniny, ktorú dostaneme.
And it is possible that they are going to come to us maybe in the can or in the meat or something like that.
A dostávajú sa do našeho organizmu bez toho, aby sme o tom vedeli.
So we actually unconsciously eat them without even knowing it.
Samozrejme, následkom je úhyn rýb a živočichov.
And as a result, as one of the results, many, many animals, including fish, die.
Strata biodiverzity.
And the loss of the biodiversity.
Ďalšou témou, s ktorou som sa stretla, keď som sa zaoberala postapokalyptickou krajinou, je pestovanie bavlny samotné.
Another problem that I would like to explore that I came across while doing my project was the cotton itself, basically.
Najväčšími exportérmi sú napríklad Čína, India, USA, Pakistan.
The biggest exporters are India, China, the United States, Pakistan,
Brazil, Uzbekistan, Turkey, Australia, Turkmenistan, Mexico, for example. There is a lot. Bavlna sa pestuje v zásade v dvoch typoch organizácie pestovania.
So the cotton can be held in two kinds.
Prvým sú veľké spoločnosti, ktoré majú plne mechanizované pestovanie.
First of all, it can be tested by a very big enterprise, by a very big company, that everything and the whole process in these companies is mechanized.
A druhým, rovnako výrazným, sú malí pestovatelia.
And the second one, basically they are all the small producers, small independent producers.
Or farm holders. A títo súťažia s tými veľkými pestovateľmi.
And they are competing against each other.
Ceny sú opäť stlačené veľmi nízko.
The prices are very low again.
Takže pestovatelia bavlny napríklad v Indii sa počas celého svojho života nedostanú z dlhu.
So it's very common that producers, cotton producers in India don't even go out of the debt because
Dlh vzniká nákupom semien bavlny.
Since the debt basically borns when you start buying all the sources to produce the cotton.
Následne bavlna vyžaduje zase agrochemické prostriedky na ošetrenie.
Next the cotton needs all the agrochemical treatment. All the products to be able to maintain it.
Ktoré sú tiež veľmi drahé.
Which are also very expensive.
A potom vlastníci pôdy, keď nie sú schopní platiť dlhy.
Then the landowners, if they're not able to pay back the debts.
Dokonca páchajú sebevraždy.
They do even commit suicides.
Väčšinou na pestovanie bavlny sa zúčastňuje celá rodina.
It's usual that all the family participates if there is a cotton business going on.
A celý proces je veľmi nebezpečný a zdraviu škodlivý, ako aj zaťažuje environment.
the whole process is dangerous, and you take risks when it comes to your health, and it's not good for the environment.
Farmári, ktorí spracovávajú bavlnu, nedodržiavajú presné návody na použitie hnojív, pesticídov, herbicídov.
All the farmers that are doing this, they don't really respect contracts and deals to make it smoothly, to make it respectfully towards the environment.
Sprejujú bavlnu o mnoho viac, než je potrebné.
And they use cotton way more than it's needed.
V množstvách, ktoré sú prehnané.
In the exaggerated amounts.
Pretože sa boja o úrodu, lebo je ich jediným zdrojom obživy.
Because they are very scared and that they're not gonna have any money, and since it's their only source of money, source of food and source of living.
Nepoužívajú žiadne ochranné prostriedky.
They don't really use anything to protect themselves.
Jednak šetria peniaze a jednak ani nie sú dostupné.
Because they want to save money, and second, they are not even available.
A platí to teda na všetkých členov rodiny, aj na ženy, aj na deti.
And this includes all the members of the family, including women and children.
A všetko je to o tom, že jednoducho nie sú peniaze, pretože predajná cena bavlny je natoľko nízka.
And everything is because they don't have money, since the normal price of the cotton is genuinely very low.
Celé spracovanie bavlny je nebezpečné.
In general, the cotton industry is just very, very dangerous.
Napríklad preto, že bavlna má schopnosť udržiavať toxické látky v sebe.
One reason that explains this is the fact that cotton has the ability to contain and to maintain deep inside all the chemicals.
Keď je sprejovaná v čase, keď už je rozvinutá.
As long as it's sprayed or being cared with some toxic stuff.
Tuto sú pár fotografií rodín, ktorí stratili vlastne jediného živiteľa.
These are some pictures of the families that lost their main member of the family who actually made some money.
Čísla nájdete aj v odborných publikáciách, nielen v článkoch na internete.
They are available in the publications, on the internet, and books.
Napríklad v roku 2005 viac ako 270,000 farmárov spáchalo sebevraždu.
For example, back in the year 2005, more than 270,000 farmers committed a suicide.
Kvôli dlhu.
Because of this.
Väčšinou páchajú sebevraždu tak, že vypijú fľašu s pesticídmi.
Usually they commit a suicide in a way that they drink up the bottle full of pesticides.
Another topic. Ďalšia téma, ku ktorej som sa dostala.
Another topic that I came across.
Bola nútená detská práca, alebo nútená práca všeobecne.
Was the fact that kids are working.
Známy je prípad Uzbekistanu a jeho bavlny.
For example, in Uzbekistan.
Kde boli vlastne obyvateľia štátom nútení sa zúčastňovať na zbere bavlny.
Where all the inhabitants of the state were obliged to participate in the cotton picking.
Školopovinné deti.
Even the students' schools.
Zber bavlny môže trvať zhruba 2-2,5 mesiaca na konci leta, na začiatku jesene.
The cotton picking can last 2 or 3 months.
Takže školy na začiatku jesene boli zatvorené.
So the schools were closed.
A deti 10, 11, 12 ročné museli ísť na polia.
And all the children starting at age 10, they just had to go to the field and help.
Nedostávali žiadnu alebo veľmi malú výplatu.
They didn't get paid, or if they did, it was such a small salary.
Ale pretože z tej výplaty sa ešte odpočítavali náklady na dopravu na polia, stravu a ubytovanie.
But because all the parts were taken away, numbers to pay the transportation, to pay the fee, to pay the field, to pay another workers, they basically got nothing.
Alebo dokonca zostávali v dlhu, keď sa skončila sezóna zberu bavlny.
Or they even could have ended up in the debt.
Ak nemohli sami ísť na pole, tak boli nútení nájsť za seba náhradného robotníka, ktorého mali zaplatiť.
If it wasn't possible for themselves to go and pick the cotton, then they should have basically find someone else to replace them and then even pay him.
Približne od roku 2004 Environmental Justice Foundation sleduje tento prípad, okrem teda nútenej detskej práce aj environmentálne škody, a každý rok vydávajú report.
So ever since the year 2004, the Environmental Justice Organization is monitoring the situation and informing the rest of the world.
Takže všetky informácie, vlastne, ktoré som vám doteraz hovorila, sú dostupné, len si musíme nájsť čas a pozrieť sa na ne.
So all the information that I shared with you are available on the internet, but it's very important to find some time and just like look it up.
Môžeme hovoriť približne o 2 miliónoch detí, ktoré sa zúčastňovali na zbere bavlny.
I'm talking approximately about 2 billion of kids that have participated in the forced labor.
V tejto sezóne sú vlastne ubytovaní vo veľmi zlých podmienkach, spia na zemi.
During this season they are accommodated in a very bad conditions, they sleep on the floor.
Nemajú skoro žiadne jedlo.
They don't really have food.
Ani vodu, pričom teploty sú na konci leta vysoké.
Not even water, and the worst part is that all the temperatures in Uzbekistan are very high the end of the season.
Takže napríklad pijú vodu priamo zo zavlažovacích kanálov.
So they actually drink, they are forced to drink water from the irrigation canals.
A rovnako, keď sa vyskytli protesty proti tomuto správaniu.
And even though there have been protests before this behavior, against this behavior.
Tak sa na niektorých územiach odstránila detská práca, ale museli ich nahradiť napríklad pedagógovia zo škôl.
So it had a certain outcome because at some places the kids were just like told not to work, but they had to be replaced by teachers and professors.
Nasledujúca koláž je o tom, že zbieranie bavlny deťmi.
This collage is about like a concrete cotton picking by children.
Není iba záležitosť Uzbekistanu.
It's not only the situation in Uzbekistan.
A zase je to všetko o výslednej cene produktu.
And everything is about the final price of the product.
Ďalší známy prípad týkajúci sa výroby textilu alebo módy alebo odevu.
Another famous case when it comes to the fashion and textile industry
je Rana Plaza.
Is the Rana Plaza building,
ktorá sa zrútila.
That fell apart.
24. apríla 2013, možno ste o tom počuli.
The 24th of April 2003, maybe you heard about it.
V budove sa nachádzali pracovníci textilného priemyslu.
Back in the building there were all the workers.
Pracujúci pre známe značky.
That have been working for very famous fashion brands.
Napríklad Mango, Benetton, Primark, Walmart.
For example, Mango, Benetton, Primark, Walmart.
Večer predtým, alebo deň predtým, bolo jasné, že s budovou není niečo v poriadku.
The evening or the night before was kind of obvious that there is something wrong with the building.
Pretože na stenách sa objavili trhliny.
Because there were some kind of holes on the wall.
Ale pracovníci boli aj tak na druhý deň nútení prísť naspäť do práce kvôli tomu, aby stihli termíny.
But even though, I mean, even that this happened, all the workers have been forced to come to the work the day after to meet all the deadlines.
A architekti, ktorí pracovali na tej budove, povedali, že nebola konštruovaná pre ťažké textilné mašiny.
And architects that have been working and designing the building said that it wasn't really designed in order to be able to haul very heavy stuff, very heavy machines.
A že vibrácie a váhu vlastne, alebo teda váhu a vibrácie, ktoré spôsobujú, nemohla uniesť.
And that it was simply impossible for it to keep up with such a big weight.
Takže rovnakým problémom je bezpečnosť pracovníkov v textilnom sektore.
which brings us to the conclusion that a very big problem and the very big issue is the safety of all the workers in the textile and fashion industry,
ktorá je veľmi nedostačujúca,
which is usually not even available,
práve kvôli zase nízkej cene výsledného produktu.
Again, because of the low price of the final product.
A ďalším problémom je fakt,
another problem is the fact,
že spoločnosti, ktoré vlastne sa na tomto podieľajú,
that the companies that are contributing to this,
alebo značky, ktoré brands, vyrábajú v takýchto podmienkach,
or the brands that are that hire workers working in such conditions,
sa absolútne nezaujímajú o podmienky svojich pracovníkov.
They don't really care about this. They don't really care about the quality, about the life of their workers.
V čase, keď sa zrútila budova,
back when the building crumbled,
bolo v nej približne 3122 pracovníkov.
Inside was about 3122 workers.
2500 bolo zranených približne.
2500 were injured.
A približne 1100 mŕtvych.
And more or less 1000 died.
Niektorí z pozostalých sa časom dostali k odškodneniu.
Some of the families from of the workers maybe later got some reimbursement, some money.
Niektorí nie, lebo neboli schopní doložiť oficiálne papiere.
Some of them didn't because they weren't able to give any evidence, to give any connection to whom they actually belonged.
A približne 28 z 29 modných značiek.
And approximately 28 out of 29 fashion brands
prispeli do fondu, vlastne, ktorý slúžil na odškodnenie pozostalých.
Contributed to the financial fund that has been created to support the family of the dead and injured workers.
Život pracovníkov v textilnom priemysle je už tak či tak veľmi veľmi chudobný.
Anyways, the life of the workers working in the fashion and textile industry is just very hard, dangerous, and they live in poverty.
Väčšinu svojho poddimenzovaného platu dajú za ubytovanie a vodu a jedlo.
Because they use the majority of their very low salary to pay their rents and food and water.
Krajina je už znečistená a tak je ťažký prístup k nezávadnej pitnej vode, ktorá stúpa na cene.
And since the land is already pretty damaged, it's hard to get a drinkable water for a low price.
A pri tejto katastrofe vlastne často rodiny stratili jediného živiteľa.
And this is why it's very usual for these families to lose their main financial supporter, the person in the family that actually earns some money.
Ďalším závažným diskutovaným problémom,
another very controversial topic is,
je geneticky modifikovaná bavlna,
is the genetically modified cotton.
Po celom svete sa vyskytuje mnoho protestov proti použitiu geneticky modifikovanej bavlny.
There are many strikes and protests around the world against the genetically modified cotton,
ktorá je už v súčasnosti veľmi rozšírená.
That's very spread around the world in these times nowadays.
Napríklad v Indii je ťažké dostať sa k bavlne, ktorá nie je geneticky modifikovaná.
For example, in India it's very hard to get in touch with the genetically non-modified cotton.
Takže farmár v podstate ani nemá na výber, či si kúpi štandardnú bavlnu alebo geneticky modifikovanú.
So the farmer can't even decide whether he's gonna purchase a genetically modified or not modified cotton.
Geneticky modifikovaná bavlna bola vyvinutá, aby zlepšila odolnosť bavlny.
The genetically modified cotton has been created to get the durability and the quality in general better.
Napríklad voči poveternostným podmienkam alebo suchu.
In under the dry conditions or any other bad conditions.
Alebo voči predátorom, voči hmyzu, zvieratám, ktoré ohrozujú bavlnené bavlnové polia. pardon.
It was also supposed to protect the cotton against any predators, animals, anything like that.
A zásadným bolo zníženie agrochemikálií použitých pri pestovaní bavlny.
But the main part was at least a little diminishing the use of the chemicals while modify the cotton.
V mnohých prípadoch sa ale zistilo, že po niekoľkých rokoch.
However, in many cases it's been discovered that after several years.
Vlastne sa toto zníženie chemikálií dostalo späť na pôvodnú úroveň.
The original purpose of diminishing the amount of used chemicals just got back to the original level.
Firma Monsanto vlastne produkuje veľkú väčšinu agrochemických produktov.
The Monsanto enterprise is producing the big majority of the chemical products.
A produkuje rovnako aj geneticky modifikovanú bavlnu a iné, nielen bavlnu samozrejme.
As well as the modified cotton.
Kukuricu, soju, pšenicu.
Corn, wheat.
Pšenicu. Soju.
Soja.
A vlastne pri pestovaní svojej geneticky modifikovanej bavlny vyžaduje používanie určitých typov agrochemikálií, z ktorých opäť má zisky.
And while basically taking care of its genetically modified cotton, they need to and they require a use of a certain specific products and chemicals.
Napríklad do Indie sa GM bavlna dostala v roku 2002.
This kind of cotton got to India back in the year 2002.
Mala farmárom pomôcť znížiť náklady a zvýšiť výnosy.
And it was supposed to help the farmers to diminish their expenses and on the other hand like get their profit better.
Toto sa však ale nestalo, pretože GM bavlna je niekoľkonásobne drahšia.
But this didn't really happen because this cotton is quite expensive.
A rovnako aj agrochemické prostriedky, ktoré spoločnosť Monsanto predáva.
As long as the agrochemical products that the enterprise sold.
Takže v súčasnosti je skôr dopyt po klasickej bavlne, ktorá ale už nie je dostupná.
Therefore nowadays people want even more the classical cotton but it's barely available.
Problémom geneticky modifikovanej bavlny a s tým súvisiacimi chemickými prostriedkami je ničenie okolia, životného prostredia, ale aj zdravotné následky.
So all the problems connected with the genetically modified cotton and all these chemicals used to make it better involve all the damages on the health, on the people's health and also the nature.
Pretože farmári a ich rodiny nie sú nejakým spôsobom chránené.
Ever since the farmers and their families didn't get any kind of flu shot or they are not protected.
A keby aj bola nejaká dostupná ochrana, tak na ňu nemajú prostriedky.
And even if the shots or any other kind of protections were available, they could never afford it.
V oblastiach pestovania bavlny sa vyskytujú závažné ochorenia.
In the areas where the cotton is being produced, there are many
závažné ochorenia, serial
ochorenia, choroby. There are many illnesses and just sick people.
Ktoré samozrejme nie sú ošetrované. Seriózne.
That can be barely cured.
A ani sa o nich nehovorí, ani sa o nich nevie.
People don't even know about them because nobody talks about them.
Neexistujú štatistiky, nikto to nesleduje.
There are not any statistics, no one's really monitoring it.
Nikoho to v podstate nezaujíma.
People just don't care.
Ďalšou veľkou témou a v mojom prípade poslednou.
Another big topic
je odpad textilný.
Is the textile rubbish from the textile industry?
Ktorý v prípade fast fashion vzniká veľmi rýchlo.
that is being created very fast when it comes to fashion industry, especially fast fashion industry.
Pretože odevy sú už neni opravované.
Because we don't have a habit anymore to repair our clothes, we just throw them.
Nepotrebujeme si ich vážiť, pretože stoja málo.
We don't really need to appreciate them properly because the price is very low.
Takže je nám jedno, či svoj odev po dvoch, troch týždňoch zahodíme, prípadne po roku.
So we don't really care whether we threw our outfit away after a few weeks or even a year.
Pretože jednoducho ideme a kúpime si nový.
Because we go and we buy something new.
Všetky z týchto odevov boli navrhnuté a vyrobené tak, aby vydržali o mnoho dlhšie ako pol roka alebo rok.
However, all of these clothes and outfits have been designed in a way to last at least a half a year or even more than a year.
Preto teda ostávajú na skladkách alebo odchádzajú do spalovní.
That's why they stay on the
landfill.
On the landfill or they get burned.
Oba procesy narábania s odpadom sú škodlivé.
Both processes are very very bad for the nature.
Pretože z nich vznikajú škodlivé emisie alebo sa škodlivé látky uvoľňujú do vody a do zeme.
Because all the toxic things and toxic emissions are going to be produced and they are spread in the water, in the air.
Skladky sú viac menej naplnené.
However, these places are full.
A spalovne, proces spalovania odevu je finančne náročný, takže väčšinou krajiny volia uskladnenie.
And burning all these things is very expensive, therefore usually countries and places like that choose to store them.
Napríklad in UK za rok vznikne 2,35 milióna tón textilného odpadu.
So for example, in a year there's usually 2.35 billion of this rubbish.
Čo je približne 40 kilo na osobu.
Which is approximately 40 kilos per person.
Toto je len jeden z údajov. Takýchto údajov nájdete rôznych všade veľa. V každom prípade tieto údaje rastú.
However, this is only one information out of many and you can find them on the internet.
Veľmi, veľmi malinké percento z textilu, ktorý je vyhodený, je recyklované.
There is such a small percentage of the clothes that are being thrown away, which is actually recycled.
Niečo ide do second-hand obchodov.
Something goes to the second-hand stores.
A niečo na charitu.
Something goes to the charity.
Charita znie dobre.
Charity sounds good.
Ale nie je natoľko úspešná.
But it's not that successful.
Pretože napríklad v Južnej Afrike ženy a ľudia nepotrebujú odevy, ktoré nosíme my.
Because, for example, in South Africa or in Africa in general, people don't really need outfits that we wear.
Takže väčšina z toho aj tak zase skončí na skládke.
So basically all of them ended up at these places anyways.
Týchto pár slajdov, čo som vám ukázala,
these few slides that I showed you,
je len malým náznakom toho, čo spôsobuje textilný priemysel.
It's only a brief spoiler what is actually happening due to all these toxic emissions.
Ako štvrtý najväčší znečisťovateľ našej zeme.
The fourth bigger pollutant on the earth.
Takže som sa ja sama pre seba pokúšala hľadať nejaké alternatívy.
So even I try to find some and search for some alternatives.
A v súčasnosti existujú firmy.
And nowadays there are many enterprises,
ktoré sú schopné odhaliť svoj dodávateľský reťazec.
That are able to search and to get to know more their supplying chain.
Sú ochotné zaujímať sa o podmienky vzniku svojich odevov.
They are willing to spend time and investigate about conditions under which their workers make the clothes.
Ale ich produkty nestoja 5 euro.
But their products don't really cost 5 euros.
Čo je logické, pretože textilné produkty nemôžu stať 5 euro.
which is logical because all these products they simply cannot cost only 5 euros.
Napríklad firma Patagonia uverejnila reklamu, to je hore tá modrá bunda.
For example, the Patagonia brand created a commercial,
ktorá hovorí, že nekupujte si túto bundu.
Saying just don't buy this jacket.
Je to myslené v tom zmysle, že nekupujte si, ak ju naozaj nepotrebujete.
And it's basically meant in a way, don't buy it unless you really, really need it. If you don't need it, don't buy it.
Je to úplne jednoduchá matematika. Ak si nekúpime 3 bundy za 20 eur za rok, tak si môžeme kúpiť jednu o mnoho drahšiu.
The math is easy. If you don't buy 3 jackets and each costing only 20 euros, then you can afford more expensive one and you can buy only one per year.
Takže záver, ktorý som si sama pre seba urobila.
So the conclusion that I made for myself.
Že to, čo každý z nás alebo ja môžem urobiť preto, aby som nedevastovala environment.
That the minimum that each of us can do not to devastate the environment.
Pretože ak si to tričko za 5 eur kúpim, tak to vlastne robím.
Because if you actually buy the t-shirt costing only 5 euros, you're actually doing it.
Pretože podporujem spoločnosti, ktoré to robia.
Since you support the industries and brands and enterprises that are doing so.
Dávam im moje peniaze a robím im zisk.
You're giving them my money and I make them do business.
A oni môžu pokračovať.
And they can just go on.
Takže som sa rozhodla, že to proste robiť nebudem.
So I decided not to do that anymore.
A dobrá cesta možno ako pokračovať pre mňa samotnú alebo pre každého, kto by chcel.
And a good way and the good way how to continue in this mindset for me or for anyone who would be interested.
Je viacej premýšľať a menej nakupovať.
It's to think more and shop less.
A keď budeme menej nakupovať, tak budeme mať viacej času na premýšľanie.
Plus, if I'm gonna buy less things, I'm gonna have more time for thinking.
A môžem si spraviť research a môžem naozaj nájsť spoločnosti, ktoré stoja za to.
I can do some research and maybe find companies that that are more sensitive and they really don't do these kind of things.
A ktorým dám svoje peniaze.
And that I actually want to give them my money.
No a vo svojej doktorandskej práci som sa potom posunula ku tvorbe kolekcií odevov.
Therefore afterwards in my work I moved to the actual creation of the clothes and designing.
V ktorej som spotrebovala materiály, ktoré som dlho mala doma a ležali na skrini.
Which I used all the materials that I had home for.
Potom som spotrebovala materiály od cudzích osôb, ktoré nepotrebovali.
Then I used all the materials from
od iných. Proste som from, vyzbierala.
From another people that they didn't need and I used them.
Použila som second-handové odevy.
I used many second-hand outfits.
Použila som nepotrebné textílie z automobilového priemyslu napríklad.
I used textiles from the car industry.
A snažila som sa svojimi odevami, materiálom dať nový život.
And I try to give them a new life.
Na tomto obrázku napríklad vidíte textilný materiál z reklamného pútača billboardu.
You can in this picture you can see the material from the advertisement billboard,
ktorý je ale spracovaný tak, aby bol nositeľný, je počitý.
Which is worked in a way to be wearable and simple.
Takže moja kolekcia je vlastne odkazom toho, že skúsme sa zamyslieť nad tým, čo všetko už máme.
Therefore the message I'd like to convey in my collection is let's think about the amount of stuff that we have.
A skúsme sa zamerať na to, čo máme a nekupovať stále nové a nové veci.
And just like think about what we actually have already and how we can use it instead of buying and keep buying new stuff.
Pri tvorbe týchto fotografií som spolupracovala s firmou, ktorá recykluje drevo.
while doing these pictures, I collaborated with a firm that devoted its being for the wood recycling.
Keď som tvorila tú kolekciu, tak som ešte potrebovala sa ako keby chytiť nejakého príbehu.
While I was doing the collection, I really needed to get caught up in the story.
Takže som vlastne sama jeden príbeh napísala o žene, ktorá vlastne prežila koniec sveta.
Therefore I wrote myself one. It's about a woman who survived the end of the world.
A o jej putovaní.
And about her journey.
A tu som vlastne v tom príbehu teoreticky obliekla.
So theoretically I dressed up her in the story.
Z materiálov, ktoré bola schopná na svojej ceste nájsť.
From the materials that she came across during her long journey.
Ďakujem veľmi pekne za pozornosť.
That's it. Thank you so much.